Morocco's great problem is water, or the lack of it. With water, the land can grow literally anything. Without it, the land is arid and barren. To bring water to the Moroccan farmers, the government has already built 7 dams, among the most important in North Africa, and 3 more are under construction. The dam of Bin El Widan, deep in the Atlas Mountains, and highest dam in Africa, serves 2 purposes. It controls the water of the El Abid River for irrigation, and it provides electricity for an immense slice of Morocco, from Casablanca to Oujda on the Algerian frontier. The water for irrigation is brought to the Tadla Plain, a great once arid valley north of the Middle Atlas Range, through huge canals. Through a complex of smaller canals, water stretches out in a grid across the plain, and through a series of sluices, it reaches the farmers' own fields. As a result, Morocco today has almost 500,000 acres of land under irrigation. Eventually, 1,250,000 will be irrigated. And how does this benefit the Moroccan farmer? Today, through irrigation, he is sure of water for his crops. Instead of relying on the chance of rain or his primitive earth dams and canals, he can now raise his crops in security. He can vary them too, growing a variety and quantity he never before thought possible. In the Tadla Plain, this quiet and peaceful revolution is happening. The government, through its experimental nurseries, has encouraged the farmers to grow market crops. And prosperity is now in sight for the small crop farmers of the Tadla Plain. The small farms of the Tadla are still unmechanized, but in the wheat fields of the north, mechanized agriculture is an accepted fact. Here, the Moroccan farmer, either individually or through his agricultural cooperatives, has eagerly accepted mechanization. Thanks to the irrigation ditch, the patterns of Morocco's land are changing. Irrigation is bringing prosperity to the Tadla Plain, a prosperity well demonstrated on market day. The marketplace, called the souk, is in a town in the center of the irrigation project. Farmers and their families come to the souk from miles around to sell cows or trade donkeys. Or camels. A full-grown camel can bring as much as $70. A baby camel, $20. Bargaining is not only an economic necessity, it is truly part of a Moroccan's way of life. And once the donkey is sold, the farmer carefully scrutinizes every franc note he received in payment. As a supplement to the irrigation project in the Tadla Plain are the hydroelectric plants at Bin El Widan and Afouré, which will have, at full capacity, an electric output of 212,000 kilowatts, producing 550 million kilowatt hours a year. A formidable achievement for the newly developing country. Because of increasing industrialization, the country nomads are moving to the cities which cannot absorb them. So they build their own tin can towns called bidonvilles. To correct this, the government has undertaken a continuing long-range program, building new medinas. Housing is a major concern of the Sharifian government and the French. In 1 3-year period, they have built over 20,000 homes and thousands more are under construction. Morocco, which is about the size of California, has an excellent highway and railroad system, joining all the major cities. The capital of the country is Rabat. This city, which once was rich and powerful under the sultans of the 12th and 13th centuries, was restored to her former prestige by Leo Tay, who chose Rabat to be the Moroccan capital, seat of both the Sharifian government and the residency general. The new city of Rabat was planned by Leo Tay. The capital is connected by rail, bus, and air with all of Morocco. The influence of the Moorish Andalusian architecture is reflected in Rabat's public buildings. Rabat is a cosmopolitan city. Airmen from nearby American bases may even find a U.S. newspaper. Movies are better than ever in Morocco. In Phoenician times, the Chella, this ancient walled town, was a great trading center. Yaqub El Mansur, the great 12th century sultan, built the Tower of Hassan. It was to be a minaret for a great mosque. From the top of the tower, one can see the city of Saleh, once notorious as a corsair republic and bandit stronghold. South of Rabat is Casablanca, biggest port in North Africa. Casablanca, which means White House after a pasha's palace, is a boom town, a busy, hustling city of commerce and industry, largest in Morocco, with 850,000 inhabitants. For the serviceman on leave, Casablanca offers many attractions. The mushroom growth of this city is due to its commerce and trade with the rest of the world. It has grown as fast as some of the boom towns of the American Southwest and is the most modern of Morocco's cities with its skyscrapers and new apartment houses. East meets West in the architecture of a Roman Catholic church. But new apartment houses are completely Western. The posters are uniquely Gaelic, gay and lighthearted. It is a city of contrasts, ancient slums against the background of 20th century buildings. Casablanca is the aerial gateway to Morocco. Almost all European travelers enter and leave the country from here. Morocco's domestic airline makes travel within the country pleasant and easy. What can you see in Morocco? Well, for example, goats in trees. Yes, trees. These goats climb the argan trees to eat its nuts and leaves. Capital of the South, stronghold of the Berber people, oasis in the desert, the fabulous city of Marrakech. Marrakech, the red city, so called because its earthen ramparts are a warm reddish pink. Like all Moroccan cities, Marrakech is surrounded by an ancient wall which protects its palaces and gardens, its 250,000 inhabitants. The city is dominated by the minaret of the Koutoubia Mosque, Morocco's finest. Marrakech is also renowned as the home of El Glaoui, the city's pasha and chief of the Glaoua tribe, an old-time Berber leader. His palace is one of the showplaces of the city, quiet and serene behind its high garden walls. In sharp contrast is the Broadway of Marrakech, Jama El Fana, which means the meeting place of the dead. For centuries, Moroccan travelers have visited this square to shop, to trade, to look, to be entertained. Here are sword dancers, singers, and snake charmers. In the tradition of the tales of the Arabian Nights, Moroccans still enjoy a good storyteller. Near Marrakesh is El Glaoui's golf course, which he has opened to the public. American servicemen from the nearby base of Nuasser take advantage of this course, probably the only one in the world where camels graze on the green. Marrakesh has other wonders too. One of them is the Minara Pavilion. North and east from Marrakesh is Fes, one of Islam's holy cities. Fes is an Arab city, and her souks are famous throughout North Africa. Fes, one of the four imperial cities of the Sultan, considers herself capital of the North. In the narrow streets of the Medina, shops sell a bewildering variety of goods from famous Moroccan leatherwork to gowns called jellabads. The government encourages Moroccan handicrafts at the Bata Museum in Fes. Here, traditional Moroccan arts and crafts are developed and preserved. A father passes on his knowledge and skills to his young son, cherishing an age-old art in a world which is fast forgetting old ways and old crafts. In the bookbinding shop, Fes workmen tool the incomparable leather for which their city is famed. The Moroccan people today are keenly aware of their country's great and colorful past. They know, too, that the present is a time of flux and change, that their partnership with the French will be put to the test. But they look forward confidently to a productive and fruitful future, a future built on cooperation between all the people, Berber and Arab, Jew and European, farmer and city dweller. And through this cooperation, they see before them a golden age for Morocco, where all the people can enjoy, in peace and security, the blessings of a happy life for themselves and for their children.